Good evening. I wanted to start. I had a nice little meditation on the way to Mass this morning on eternal realities, heaven, hell, purgatory, and it all happened in the elevator. I'd like to share it with you. So I'm on the sixth floor, and we realized that several of the elevators were out, so someone said, "Why don't we just catch one going up, and then we'll bring it back down?" Seemed reasonable at the time. Little did we know it had been called up by someone on the 25th floor. So here I am, trying to get to the wedding feast of the Lamb, my foretaste of heaven for today. And more people are getting on at every floor. Now, I thrive in awkwardness, and riding on an elevator is so awkward because for whatever reason, people have a pass to break social norms, like spatial norms, for example. And then the things people say, like someone got on and they're like, "Ooh, somebody smells good in here." Who can own up to that? I mean, it's like, "It's me." Anyway, so we get to the 25th floor, and now we're descending. And we're stopping at every single floor without fail. And I'm like, "Is Buddy the Elf on the elevator? Did somebody light up all the buttons?" So we get to about the 20th floor, and the doors open up, and there stands Curtis Martin and his wife, Michael Ann, and their sweet baby, Michael. And I was like, "Oh, they should come on in." And somebody goes, "There's no room." And the doors close. I'm like, "I'm surrounded by innkeepers. Joseph, Mary, baby Jesus." You know, and I wasn't the only one who felt this way, because one of the guys goes, "We're all going to have to answer for that at the final judgment." I was feeling guilty, but I wasn't culpable, only because there were seven people in front of me. I couldn't get there. So I'm like, "This is purgatory. This is a foretaste of purgatory." And every time the doors opened and closed, we bounced a little. And the girl next to me, she's got her coffee like up to here. She goes, "I don't feel so good." I was like, "Oh my, if she throws up on my veil." I said, "This isn't purgatory, because all hell is about to break loose." I was like, we finally got to the lobby and I am running to Mass. And I have a whole new understanding of why we begin with, "Lord, have mercy." So let's start with a prayer. So let's pray for that mercy to come down. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, come. You are welcome here. Come, Spirit of love. Love between the Father and the Son. Cry out in our hearts. Abba, Father. Confirm us in our identity, help us to receive. Come through Mary. Mary, be a mother to us tonight. Amen. So this is eternal life, to know you, the one true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you sent. Tonight, I want to talk about the Father. I want to talk about the eternal life that he gave us and Jesus, whom he sent. I want to talk, secondly, about the Father who shows us mercy. And lastly, I want to talk about the Father who calls us and sends us out. The Father himself loves you, the Father himself shows you mercy, and the Father himself calls you and sends you. Jesus is the Word spoken by the Father. And his Word became flesh and dwelt among us. In receiving the gift of prayer, may we come to know these truths. May we come to understand that the Father revealed himself in this one word that he spoke to us. Before we can become doers of the word, we have to first realize what the word did for us, what the word is doing for us, what he will do for us. And this realization comes in prayer, in first being with him, in allowing him to be with us. A disciple is one who is learning, always learning, with their gaze fixed on the good teacher. You know, there was a point in college when I thought very seriously about being a teacher, and I decided to shadow Sister Immaculata, who had been teaching kindergarten for, I don't know, 50 years. No one really knew how long she'd been teaching kindergartners. There was one boy in the class named Corey, and he was my favorite. The child had three cowlicks on his head that converged into one, so he perpetually looked like he just got up from a nap. I mean, oh, he had these colored braces on his legs, and the other children took turns holding his hand wherever he went because he was a little unsteady in walking. And for whatever reason, the fragrance of maple syrup was upon him. I'd be like, Corey, did you have pancakes for breakfast? Waffles? The maple sugar flavored brown pack in the oatmeal variety pack? No. Did you happen to apply maple syrup directly to your scalp? It was uncanny, but I loved him. So one day, Sister Immaculata had meticulously written her entire lesson plan on the board. And Corey calls out and says, Sister Immaculata, I know how to read. Now, mind you, he's only 5 years old. And Sister Immaculata says, oh, you do, Corey. Go pick out a book. She turns and she erases the entire board. Children, everyone get up. Come sit around Corey. He's going to read us a story. And there Corey sat up, perched her bar stool, and he read the book to the class, turning the pages so proudly. All of the illustrations were for all of the children to see. I pulled her aside after I witnessed this. I said, Sister Immaculata, you know, Corey called out, changed your lesson plan, set you back a day. I just was wondering, do you mind explaining your rationale? And she smiled at me, and she replied, the self-confidence that just gave Corey, I can't teach that. And the inspiration he just gave every child in the classroom to learn how to read, I can't teach that. Sister Immaculata had the big picture. And I had a very limited, very narrow view. And to begin by saying, the Father himself loves you, we have to realize the Father has the big picture. He's at work with the whole of my life. He's at work with everyone else's life, the life of the church, the life of the world in their entirety. God sees you. He knows everything about you. All of the intricacies and the sensitivities. And he knows what he's about. He knows that he deliberately bestowed upon you, within you, unique attributes that reflect something of his glory, of his beauty, of his goodness. These attributes were entrusted to you personally, intentionally. You are the only one who communicates them. Most of us can relate totally to the Apostle Philip when he tells Jesus, show us the Father, and that'll be enough for us. Whatever your relationship with your earthly father has been, the Catechism is clear. No one is Father as God is Father. When we go into prayer, we also long to see the Father, to know the Father. We want to be confirmed. I want to know that the Father loves me and accepts me Jesus replies, "Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. As the Father loves me, so I love you." And then he cuts right to the chase. "The Father himself loves you." Our Heavenly Father is incomparable. His fatherhood is unparalleled. His affirmation, his presence, his providence, unshakable, unfailing. He makes all things work for the good for those who love him. The Father himself loves you intimately, personally. He's deeply interested and he's deeply invested in you, in your life, and what happens to you. Now, I don't know if it's because I'm a sister of life, but the miracle of conception blows my mind. I mean, the timing alone. If you think about it, if your parents conceived 1 month prior to or 1 month after your actual date of conception, you would not be here. That child conceived would be a sibling of yours instead of you. It's unbelievable that the Lord chose you. He wanted you to be here. You were conceived. You were conceived because of two particular people who were preceded by two unbroken lines of ancestors who all lived to their childbearing years. I mean, that's incredible. If even one person was taken out of either of those lines because of war, famine, the bubonic plague, you would not be here. God wanted you. He took you from utter nothingness, and he willed you into being. To be is to be loved. How good it is to be. When his disciples asked him how to pray, Jesus said, "Go into your inner room, close the door, be alone with your Father who sees you in secret and rewards you in secret." This work of the Father is not always evident to me, but it's happening even now. As we speak, the Father is at work. Within his gaze, you are safe. You're safe with him. You're safe with him because your origin is in him. All he wants is for you to receive his love. We just founded a convent out in Colorado. And our sisters out there, they met Andy. Andy is a 35-year-old sacristan, and he used to be the altar server at the parish and asked the parish priest to become a sacristan. And Andy has Down syndrome. And one day he was giving the sisters a tour, and he said to them, "I hope you can understand me okay. I have Down syndrome." And the sisters assured Andy of his clarity, thanked him for his consideration. Now, one of my sisters, she's always trying to get an edge on the spiritual life. She picked up that Andy was an insider. So she started, kind of pulled him aside. She was like, "Andy, do you pray?" "Yes, sister, every day." "You must be close to God." "Oh, very close." "Is he your best friend?" "No, I have friends. This is different. It's more like we're one. He's in me, and I'm in him, and we're one." Wow. I mean, that, my friends, is called the unitive way. If you're not there yet, you can join me in reading about it in St. Teresa of Avila's writings. At that point, every sister shamelessly wrote down her name and personal intentions on scraps of paper for Andy. We're one. We're one. You became one with Jesus at your baptism. You're one with Jesus. He takes away our sin, and he keeps doing it. He removes our burdens, even the burden of feeling that I am a burden, that my existence is a burden. Jesus tells us that his love is more than any of the burdens that have been put on me or that I have placed on myself. He wants to be with us. Jesus came and Jesus comes, and he makes his dwelling in your soul. The reality is the call and the gifts of God are irrevocable. He's telling us over and over again, I just want to be with you, and I will take away any burden that keeps me from you and you from me. All I have to do is say yes, and this yes is always possible. The Father himself loves you, and he gives himself to you, and this is mercy. The Father himself shows you mercy. You know, if you've been to Manhattan, you've seen some men sporting this kind of New York, tough guy, street look. And I just want to explain it to you. So the waistband of the pants falls somewhere between mid-calf and kneecap. The belt is not functioning as it was intended at all. And there's like 5 solid inches of boxer just plainly exposed. And it might not be solid. It might be plaid. It might be paisley. Whatever. So one of my sisters was walking along, and a young man sauntered in front of her looking like that. And this particular sister, she's a little older, and she's a New Yorker herself. So you can imagine it was kind of like something out of the Gospels where the Lord looks on the rich young man, looking upon him. She loved him. But she also felt a little embarrassed for him, and quite frankly, a little embarrassed for herself. So she started to pray, and she said, "Oh, Lord, I know that's not who that young man is. Somebody should say something to him. If he turns around, I'll do it." Now, he's like 20 feet ahead of her at this point. But would you believe it? As if forgetting something, he turns in his place, starts walking back towards sister. It's at this point she noticed he's also wearing a ginormous head of Christ in gold around a chain. And he approaches. Now, instead of saying, "Hey, have some decency and pull your pants up," she sees him coming and she says, "Hey, I like your Christ head." He's like, "Oh, you know, thanks, sister." She's like, "What's your name?" They start talking. And sister goes, "You know what? You look like someone people respect." And he's like, "Yeah, they do." She's like, "When you talk, people listen, don't they?" He's like, "You're right." She goes, "You know what? We need leaders like you." And she meant it. She meant every word of it. And as they're about to part, she goes in. And she said, "You know, can you do me a favor?" "Sure, sister." could you pull your pants up? Sure, sister. You know, that's fidelity. When we go into prayer, the Lord sees us. And he sees when we're trying to be someone we're not. What does he do? He knows us through and through. He affirms the good, and then with great reverence, calls us higher. He calls us higher, and he does so without condemning. He does so without offending, without condemning. And we have to remember, the Lord never accuses us, and he never discourages us. He's all mercy. You know, we can be afraid. We can be afraid to allow the Father to do his work in us. Sometimes when I'm thinking about it, it's just like just dredging some of that stuff up. Whether it be in prayer and confession and spiritual direction, it really puts me to flight. You know, it exhausts me. It overwhelms me. It angers me. It shames me. We think to ourselves, it was bad enough the first time. Bad enough the first time around. So we hope it fades with time. And then something happens, and it's kind of like clicking the refresh button. You know, I know it's not supposed to be this way, but I really don't know how change is possible. I don't know if it's possible for me, at least. And all the while, the silent word is pleading. The word of the Father is knocking. Jesus is knocking at the door of our hearts, bidding entrance. He wants to be invited in, welcomed in. You know, he came to do the work of the Father, and the Father wants my freedom more than I do. When I'm alone with the Lord in prayer, I don't have to wear concealer, and I don't have to hide. Quite frankly, I can't hide. I don't have to pretend. I don't have to prove anything. I don't have to impress anyone. Everything is open and exposed. I can come as I am, empty-handed, awkward, unimpressive, in need of mercy. It's at this time when I come in that I can be secure in the Father's love for me, in his acceptance of me. And he's the one who fills the empty hands. You know, one day we were serving a woman who is pregnant and in crisis, and I'll call her Annie. Now, Annie was extraordinary. She grew up on the streets of Brooklyn in an Irish-Italian neighborhood, and she had been baptized, made her first Holy Communion, and that was really it. She admitted she wasn't a pillar in the community at all. She'd actually given the NYPD a run for their money and came to us when she found herself pregnant. She'd come over for tea about once a week. And let's just say it was very different from the other activities she did day to day. One day, Annie asked the sister serving her, she says, "Sister, how old are you?" And sister evades the question, and she starts talking about the wit and author G.K. Chesterton, who used to answer such a question about his age according to the last time he'd been absolved in the sacrament of confession. Therefore, he was either 10 minutes old or 2 weeks old, depending on the last time he'd been made new through the sacrament. So Annie laughs, but she's fascinated with this concept that you could actually be made new in the sacrament. Sister thinks she beat her at her own game, but then she says, "Nice job, sister, changing the subject. I was born at night, but it wasn't last night." So anyway, a few days later, sister set up a phone call for her next date. And before they hang up, Annie goes, "Oh, sister, by the way, I'm 6 hours old." sister says, I'm sorry, pardon me? Yeah. I went to confession this morning. I'm 6 hours old. It was Annie's first time going to confession in over 20 years. And the priest who heard her confession walked her through step by step and wasn't surprised by any of her stories. Sister said, how did you feel when you walked out? She said, like the weight of the world was lifted off my shoulders. I feel new. When they got off the phone, Sister rang the bell. All the sisters came running, and they jumped up and down like the angels and saints in heaven, rejoicing over this one sinner who had repented. That next week, at their meeting, they threw her the big one-week birthday party. Cake and the candles and the gifts and everything, you know. It was a new beginning, a restoration of her innocence. Jesus wants to be with you. He wants you to receive his love. He was sent to bring glad tidings to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives, release for those who are oppressed. And he does this for you. He wants to do this in your own heart. Come to the poor places, the broken places, the oppressed places. Our Lady is called Undoer of Knots. She is the Mother of Mercy. I tell you what, you give her something gnarly, something tangled, something inextricably, painfully knotted, and she puts her fingers to it, starts loosening it up. You can tell her intercession because it's so thorough, so complete, from the inside out, so delicate, so precise. You know, the Father himself shows us mercy, and once we've received mercy, he calls us out. We have a little Christmas play every year starring the children of the women that we've served. And this year, it was the Blessed Mother's big line, her response to the angel Gabriel. And as only a Bronx 8-year-old could, with great confidence and a little attitude, she said, "Let it be done unto you according to my word." Oh, boy. Sounds familiar. Yikes. Oh, man. I tell God what he needs to do. I do it. You know, sometimes we don't want to know his will for us because there's this sneaking suspicion that it's not what I planned or that I couldn't handle it. Saying, "Let it be done unto me," with Mary requires trust. We know a 9/11 survivor who was saying that he ran down into the subway after the first plane hit, to get away to safety. And the subway was flooded with people. Everyone ran down, hoping to catch a train. And while they were waiting, the tower fell. And the whole subway tunnel was filled with the soot. And it became pitch black darkness. They were stunned. They were shocked. They were silent. Couldn't see anything. One lone voice cried out. It was the blind man who begged at that stop every day for food. And he cried out, "Everyone, follow me." This is a man who lives in darkness and knew his way out in the darkness. So all of them huddled, formed a human chain, and followed the blind man to safety. No one could look at him the same after that. You know, sometimes the one who seems to be the weakest in ordinary circumstances is the very one who's most prepared in extraordinary moments. You know, how we look at others, how we perceive their weaknesses, how we perceive our own weaknesses, only God truly sees. God equips you, and he equips you in a way that's for others. He's readying you. And a lot of times, I think we're more equipped than we think we are. Our weakness, our wounds, our emptiness can make us feel totally inadequate in serving others and leading others. You know, we can feel like, I don't even have my act together. I need mine together first, right? No, this is the wild thing. When you're willing to accept your weakness, to accept your vulnerability, you become strong with His strength. When we let the Lord in, when we expose wounds to the healer, those dark places can radiate with compassion and empathy for others. We usually have more to give and not less when we recognize our weakness and go to the Lord to supply. You know, this baffles the world. There's joy in being vulnerable. Vulnerable with God. There's joy in living in trust. And there's peace when I surrender. You know, God asks more from us because He can provide more for us. He poured His Holy Spirit into our hearts and empowered us. You know, my brothers and sisters, the miracle of spiritual multiplication that the Lord wants to work in you and through you will not come from your wealth. And it won't come from your surplus. It comes from your happy poverty. The Lord takes your little loaves and multiplies them to feed the multitudes. He takes your widow's mite and they tip the scales. He takes your pitchers of water filled to the brim at His request and He turns it into choice wine for those who have none. This is what the Lord wants to do. This is what He is doing. Recently, our sister served a woman, and I'll call her Tanya, who had been in a long-term abusive relationship. She was pregnant and had several children already, and she scheduled an abortion. She told the sisters that the only thing that would allow her to bring this child to birth would be moving across the country, which she couldn't see as a possibility. She couldn't even begin to imagine it because of her financial situation. And our sister said, let's see what God can do. They sent out an email to our coworkers of life, and within the hour, we received a response from a gentleman whose name we didn't recognize. He not only was ready to buy all the flights, but he'd already looked up her options, airlines, dates, times. Our sisters called him immediately, and they didn't expect what he told them. He said, my wife called me when she read your email. We were expecting a baby, and today we found out that he died in her womb. He began to cry as he said, tomorrow, she'll be in the hospital delivering our son, who we won't take home. When we heard this request, we knew we had to do this for our baby. Little did he know, Tanya had scheduled her abortion for the next day. And this gift was the game changer. When we called Tanya, she was blown away and could only say, did they have a name picked out for their baby? That will be my baby's name. On the very day they lost their child in the womb, they were able to turn around and provide for a woman so she would not lose her child. Love is stronger than death. And perfect love casts out fear. From darkness and death came light and life. This is eternal life, to know you, the one true God, and Jesus Christ whom you sent. The Lord wants to be with you at every moment, in every suffering, every pain, every desire and longing. The Lord wants to receive your love, and he wants you to receive his more than anything. The Father himself loves you right now. The Father himself shows you mercy. The Father himself calls you and is calling you tonight and sending you out. Mary is also called the star of the sea. She lights the way in the darkness and in the turbulence of life's storms. On this night, this Epiphany, let us look to her, our shining star who leads us to Jesus. Let us fall on our knees and adore him, love him, receive his love. And let us ask him to prepare for us and to prepare our hearts to go home by a different route this new year. God bless you.